Although captioning was created over 20 years ago, its use is still very much in its infancy. This story and more next on Deaf Mosaic. Hello, and welcome to Deaf Mosaic. I'm Gil Eastman.
And I'm Mary Lou Novitsky. Thanks for joining us.
Since the end of the silent movie era, deaf film buffs have dreamt of being able to enjoy every new film. But theaters have no captions, and too many movies are still not captioned on tape. But there's hope for full accessibility, coming soon to theaters and video stores everywhere. 40,000. On a bitterly cold January day, a small but enthusiastic crowd gathered in front of Maryland's historic State House to show their support for a proposed law that could expand the viewing options of every deaf American. The law would require that every new videotape rented or sold in the state must be closed captioned. Moving inside, advocates for the bill held a press conference.
Truly, there are many tapes here on the table that I would like to rent or purchase, but I can't. Someone said 12% of the videotapes out there are closed captioned. Only 12%. So we could do a lot more for our consumers and for the business community, for both groups of people. And a good place to start is here in Maryland.
Despite the support of over 40 legislative sponsors, the bill was defeated by a mere 3 votes. But supporters are not about to give up, and there's always next year, either in Maryland or in one of the several other states which will be considering similar laws.
This bill needs to be passed. Everyone will win once it's passed. Keep fighting. The fight is not over yet. We will win.
While legislators debate the home market, new captioning technology will soon make the big screen accessible to all. Over several evenings, selected deaf theatergoers came to the Smithsonian's Air and Space Museum to try out several closed captioning systems, especially designed for the movie theater environment. For the first time, they could fully enjoy the majesty of some of the most spectacular science and nature films ever made, on an IMAX screen more than 5 stories tall.
Are we living, loving, working, dying?
Their opinions will help select the best of 4 options, including virtual vision, which superimposes a screen full of captions over the theater screen using a pair of mini TV glasses. Rear view captioning, a simple mirror that reflects captions projected in reversed letters on the rear wall of the theater.
But again and again, survivors return to rebuild.
VFD, vacuum fluorescent display, an electronic message display easily adjustable. And finally, closed captions projected at the bottom of the screen and visible only when viewed with special polarized glasses.
The great enthusiasm we have of realizing that the museum is making efforts to make all of its exhibits accessible to everybody. And that's a wonderful thing. It's only been within the last 10 years. 10 years ago, nobody said, did anything about it. They said, sorry. Now it says, how can we? Let's figure it out. That's wonderful.
Your participation in this test is, of course, very important for us. We're trying to make a system that will work for deaf and hard of hearing people to allow you to see the captions. And we can't do that without your input.
The tests were co-sponsored by the National Center for Accessible Media.
I'm hoping that within the period of perhaps 12 months, that we'll have a system that if it's not the final system, will be a working system that we can offer people. It'll still need some refinement, it'll be experimental, but I'm hoping within perhaps a year from now, we'll be able to offer something on a regular basis.
Language is the basis for communication, whether we use our voice or hands to convey our thoughts. Learning our first language easily begins at day one, but conquering a second language is often a very long struggle. More than 7,500 participants from the United States and 80 countries recently attended the 94 Teachers of English to Speakers of Other Languages, TESOL, convention in Baltimore. TESOL was founded in 1966 and today has over 19,000 members. The association reflects the interests of classroom teachers, program administrators, teacher trainers, researchers, video and computer experts, and materials writers. One of the participants was Marlon Kuntz, bilingual and bicultural coordinator at the California School for the Deaf in Fremont. He was formerly the associate chair of Teaching English to Deaf Students, TEDS, one of TESOL's 18 special interest groups.
Many people feel that TESOL is for teaching hearing students and do not realize there is a special interest group specifically for teaching English as a second language to deaf students. TEDS advocates the acquisition of ASL as a first language. The group recognizes the importance of teaching English, but asserts that students will be faced with many frustrations without having ASL as a first language. TESOL recognizes and respects people's first language and does not attempt to oppress or do away with anyone's native language. Our group learns the techniques and concepts utilized in teaching English as a second language. Traditionally, in deaf education, there has been an English-first approach. TESOL could provide alternative approaches for teaching English.
So we would like to get a language resolution, a language rights for deaf children resolution that's supported by all of TESOL. I think that would be a real powerful tool for us all over the world. And we say language rights access for all children who are deaf all over the world because we don't want to limit it to just American children who use American Sign Language. There are deaf children all over the world that learn English and need to be taught through their native language.
The TEDS group is working on their resolution for the language rights for deaf children. TESOL supports TEDS in this endeavor to get ASL used as the instructional language in the classroom.
If that resolution on the language rights of deaf children doesn't pass, then we must stand up and fight until it passes. It would have a positive impact on deaf education. It advocates that children have language rights. It is important for children to use a natural language while growing up so that they can use it to later learn English.
If you want to know more information about TESOL and or TEDS, please write to Marie Phillip, Learning Center for Deaf Children, Incorporated, 848 Central Street, Framingham, Massachusetts, 01701-4815, or call 508-626-8121, TTY only, or fax us at 508-875-9203.
Our next story was suggested by a French student attending Gallaudet University. So, we introduced him to our Deaf Mosaic student interns who produced and edited this story. Sourds en colère is French for deaf anger, and also the name of a French organization angry about the use of cochlear implants in deaf children. Last October, 600 deaf people gathered at a conference at the Medical University of Lyon to show their opposition to the government's consideration of a law giving all deaf children free cochlear implants beginning in 1997. Eric Larif is the international liaison for Sourds en colère.
Our first and primary goal is to stop the implantation of deaf children. That's our most important goal. We also want to stop the French government from providing funding for almost 100 free cochlear implants yearly, which they are doing now. We want to establish an information center, which would include both deaf and hearing views, both the positive and negative aspects of cochlear implants. We want to see both opinions included.
Only 5 deaf people out of 20 who registered for the conference were permitted to enter, and once in, they were denied the opportunity to express their views. One person did get the chance to ask why the Royer Law, a law guaranteeing full access to information and decision-making powers by people subject to medical experiments, was not being applied to deaf people with cochlear implants. And an emotional high point was reached when a formerly implanted person smashed his implant to pieces before the crowd. According to information from Sources en Colère, 2,600 people in France use cochlear implants, and approximately 600 of them are children.
We will never give up. We will continue to protest forever. We will never stop.
Do you know what a skinny mini is? A cafe latte? A Eurodark? If you don't, you will, after visiting the business of this enterprising young man. Just minutes from the University of Maryland's College Park campus is International Express, one of the newest coffee houses to sprout up on the East Coast. But here you can get more than just a steaming cup of espresso, because owner Joel Barrish is also a travel agent and has combined his 2 businesses under one roof. Now Joel's customers can sip a cappuccino while booking flights to Acapulco.
The combination of coffee shop and travel agency seems to work out well. Some customers come in to buy airline tickets. It takes some time to check for the best flights and the best prices. So while the person is waiting, they can sit, drink coffee, and read instead of just having the time go to waste while I do the dirty work. Once I'm finished, if the person buys a ticket, I give him free coffee. So the person leaves happy, leaving with his ticket and his coffee and with a good feeling inside.
Joel's first coffee shop was established at his alma mater, Gallaudet University, in 1993. Encouraged by the rapid success and growth of his first shop, Joel spawned the second shop a year later, just a 20-minute drive away.
When I first set up the business, I thought a lot about communication. It is important that communication not be a barrier. I made a stack of paper available. I got different sizes of coffee mugs and displayed them. Now, all anyone has to do is simply point or write. Most people are very willing to do so. It is also fairly easy to lip-read coffee orders. I sell 20 different kinds of coffee beans. And I also have 5 special plantation beans, which are grown on a very limited basis in the United States. The best tasting coffee is the Jamaican Blue Mountain coffee. It tastes so smooth that even at $35 a pound, it still tastes good.
Wendy Payne is International Express's general manager. Since Joel established the business 2 months ago, I've been helping him with getting the place in shape. I've learned a lot about the process of setting up a business. It isn't very easy. It's a very complex process. I'm happy to have been able to learn from this experience. Maybe someday I will set up a business of my own. Who knows?
When I established the business, I was trying to figure out how to attract more people in the evenings. I thought about having a place to study. I have 2 areas for study, one with tables and chairs all in a row, and another which is a study room, or it can be a social room. I had an idea to hold ASL workshops here. Well, not really workshops, but seminars is a better word. They're more like discussion groups, so people can have question and answer sessions.
I come here every Wednesday night. And I come here just for the purpose of having conversation and talking with hearing people. They want to learn sign language. And not only that, they want to know about deafness and deaf culture.
What is that? Together?
So we talk, and they ask me questions, and I explain things. I really enjoy it.
This is far from a leisure activity for Joel Barrish. This rising entrepreneur knows that students survive and thrive on coffee, and he plans to open 3 more shops adjacent to college campuses in the near future.
It's been many years since ASL was recognized here in the U.S. as a language all its own. Now communities around the world are studying their own sign languages in order to assert their linguistic rights.
There is a man named Lars Wallen who is about to become the world's first deaf PhD in Swedish Sign Language next week. Here at the University of Stockholm, the process to become a PhD is different than it is in America. A woman from Denmark will come. She is a linguist and has studied the field of sign language for many years. She'll talk about the book that Lars has written before an audience. Afterwards, there'll be a question and answer session with Lars. We'll show you that session now. Before a packed crowd at Stockholm University's Institute of Linguistics, Lars Wallen presented details of his research into the nature of Swedish Sign Language. Wallen, a deaf researcher, has spent his professional life observing the signs and language used by Swedish deaf people. Based on similar work conducted in the United States that led to the recognition of ASL as a language unto itself, Wallen has described the grammar and symbols that have naturally developed into a complete and effective sign language used throughout the Swedish deaf community. Now he must explain his research and conclusions to expert linguists.
I've been studying for about 10 years, working and studying towards this goal. So I feel good that I'll actually be finished. I'm happy.
You're the first deaf person to have done this. Why is that?
Many people will be unsure about what this all means. It is true that many deaf people have PhDs. I am not the first deaf person to get a PhD. And I am not the first deaf person to write about sign language. Others have written about sign language within such fields as linguistics and psycholinguistics. However, I am the first person to have written about signs in Swedish sign language. That is what makes my work different. I used a method whereby I could analyze Swedish signs and wrote about that. That is my PhD work.
What problems have you had in your work? What barriers have you faced?
Do you mean in my studies or research or what?
In your studies and research and all aspects of your work.
Well, in most of my linguistic studies, I was alone. I had an interpreter. One problem, however, was that it was difficult to have discussions about sign language in these classes. The hearing people didn't know about sign language. If I had been with a group of deaf people, it would have been easier to discuss the topic of sign language.
What changes or influences will your work have in the future?
People will know more about sign language. I think people will know more. It is good for teachers in schools for the deaf. They will understand more about the deaf children's language and be able to make comparisons with spoken Swedish. Also, I think it will help in teacher training so that deaf teachers can teach hearing people to be better signers. That is what I think my research will do.
What do you think it will be like here in Sweden 10 years from now?
Better. More deaf people will have their PhDs. Yes, not only in sign language, but in other areas.
In a variety of different fields.
We will be stronger. We will have better schools and many things.
You went to Gallaudet in the United States and did 6 months of research work there. How did you like it?
It was good for me. I went to Gallaudet for 6 months. That was 3 or 4 years ago. 4 years ago. I went for the purpose of getting help with my dissertation, so that I could do the work on it. I was having difficulties in terms of how to do the research and analysis. So I went to Gallaudet and had discussions with several researchers. They were very helpful.
The examiner and audience must have been impressed, because at the end of the presentation, Lars Wallen could formally call himself Dr. Lars Wallen.
Since the time of the American Revolution, citizens of this country have been willing to take up arms to preserve their freedom. But many have had to pay the ultimate sacrifice. Others have returned home bearing the scars of battle, having to adjust to life with a war-related disability. For veterans with service-related hearing loss, there is now some help. Memorials to those who have died defending this country dot small towns and big cities nationwide. Some who survived the perils of foreign battlefields now face another battle, the fight to receive recognition and retribution for debilitating injuries. Leading the cause for veterans with hearing impairments is former Marine Don Warren, who lost his hearing during the war in Vietnam.
What happened was a rice paddy dike, a mountain of dirt. I landed here, the mortar landed here 3 foot away. It left me for the first 5-6 days fully ducked. Knocked me unconscious. I woke up in the hospital, a field hospital, and looked around and I seen these doctors and nurses. I couldn't hear nothing. When I finally realized I was deaf, it scared the hell out of me.
Disabled American Veterans, a national organization that acts as a mediator between veterans and the Department of Veterans Affairs, plays a crucial role in assuring that vets get their entitlements.
No matter what type of disability you have, all of them are considered equally severe. The VA or Department of Veterans Affairs will not take an individual with a hearing impairment and conclude that this individual with a hearing impairment, his disability is just not as severe as the guy whose legs were blown off in Vietnam. No. The purpose of the VA is to try and assist that individual the best way they possibly can. They will compensate him for his loss, as well as research and try to develop means of making his life as normal as everyone else.
The road to recovery for thousands of disabled American veterans has been elusive. For Don Warren, learning to live with his deafness and discovering what benefits were available gave him a desire to become politically active. He is adamant about helping others with service-related hearing loss obtain their VA benefits.
VA is not the enemy, really. They're doing what they can with the regulation they have now. What we need to do is get our congressmen and senators to give him more power to be able to help hearing impaired and deaf veterans even further yet. Everybody has overlooked us. If you're a hearing impaired veteran, go to your local legislators. Make yourself known, because they don't see you. If they don't see you, they won't hear you. When it comes time for new laws, they'll forget you.
Graduations are always a time of joy and celebration, a time to share accomplishments with family and friends. This year, Gallaudet University's class of 1994 shared their celebration with a very special guest, the President of the United States. Every president since Abraham Lincoln has been patron of Gallaudet University, signing each graduate's diploma. But for the first time in 30 years, a sitting president, Bill Clinton, actually visited the Gallaudet campus and addressed nearly 400 graduates, their families, faculty, staff, and friends.
I believe that being deaf or having any disability is not tragic, but the stereotypes attached to it are tragic. Discrimination is tragic. Not getting a job or having the chance to reach your God-given potential because someone else is handicapped by prejudice or fear is tragic. It must not be tolerated because none of us can afford it. We need each other, and we do not have a person to waste. The ADA is part of the seamless web of civil rights that so many have worked for so long to build in America. A constant fabric wrapped in the hopes and aspirations of all right-thinking Americans. As your president, I pledge to see that it is fully implemented and aggressively enforced in schools, in the workplace, in government, in public places. It is time to move from exclusion to inclusion, from dependence to independence, from paternalism to empowerment. For 125 years, young people have believed in themselves, their families, their country, and their future, with the courage to dream and the willingness to work to realize those dreams. You have inspired your president today and a generation. And I say to you, good luck and Godspeed.
That's our program for today. Thanks for joining us.
Until next time, when Deaf Mosaic brings you more stories from around our world, I'm Gil Eastman.
And I'm Mary Lou Novitsky. So long.